How many of you like camping? First got married, had a really fun couple. The guy is sort of goofy like me. Our wives really got along, and we said, let's go camping out to the Banff area. But we're doing this as a last-minute thing, I think. It was pretty late, that's all I know. We got there, we were the last people to check in, and the camp warden, though I can't remember his accent, I'm going to say an accent just because I think it's more interesting. Because all I remember is him being sort of that guy with the missing tooth. Not that all wardens are. If you are one and you're listening to this story. But this guy kind of had the missing tooth and the half-cocked smile. Sort of the guy you'd see in the movie Deliverance. And we were sort of checking in and we paid. And he just kind of said, be careful. There's a bear loose in the camp. Y'all have a good night. Make sure you put your food away. Right? That's all he said. Well, I didn't really care, and the other guy with me, we didn't really care. Bear loose in the camp, Banff. It's sort of a combo around here, you know. It's like, ooh, there's bears in this area. But we kind of, I remember me and the guy going to get some wood and from the camp store or whatever, the warden. And as we're walking, I thought, you know, the girls are pretty freaked about this. And he's like, yeah, you're right. We should have fun. And then, do you remember this? Okay. And all I remember is that the girls were asking us questions like, are you sure we should be here? And there's a bear in the camp. Oh, that's nothing. So we make dinner. Now it's 11 o'clock at night and we're making bacon. Now I don't know if bears are cannibals. I don't think they care. All I know is they smell good. You know what I'm saying? And so we're cooking up a storm, and we're kind of loud, and everywhere else is quiet. And then we just start making these jokes, me and the guy. I said, it's really funny how nobody else is outside. And the girls are like, well, maybe because it's a bear. We should get in the tent. Like, no big deal. Eat our bacon. Smells permeating through the campsite. And then after we're done cooking, and we're just like egging this thing on, right? I remember my buddy throws a rock in the woods, and then he's like, what was that? When the girls were looking, and then, you know? And we have this whole adventure worked out. And it got so bad that when we put our tents next to each other, and so he gets in his tent with his wife, I get in mine with my wife, and you know, tents aren't thick, so we're talking through the tent. Hey, did you guys ever hear that story about that bear mauling? And we're egging each other on. And then it's back to the bacon. It's like, well, you know, the bacon smell is pretty strong. And the girls are freaking out. Then something really weird happened. And we actually, it sort of backfired on us. And we actually started to get scared also. Like, we joked about this so much and told so many stories that now we were starting to get freaked out. And we had talked ourselves into this frenzy. So you know what we ended up doing? We tore down everything we got back in the vehicle and drove home like this from the bears. It's pathetic, I know. I was still sort of new to Calgary at that time. Now I know, I just take Reese with me and then I'm good wherever I go. And ironically, we got back, we were so scared, we didn't even put the tents up in our backyard. We put tents up in our basement suite. Do you remember that? Inside, just so that the bear followed us 100 miles away with the bacon smell, we were safe. Anyway, I want you to get this picture because it sort of served last night. Tanya and I were joking about, you know, that whole adventure. And I remember thinking, what a great parallel. Here's what you got. You got people, you got a place, the tent, and then you got some powerful being on the outside. That is exactly what Exodus 33 is all about. The person is Moses. The people are the people of Israel. The place is the tabernacle or the tent. And of course, the powerful being is God Almighty Himself. Now, when I say powerful being, that's a helpful start when we talk about devotions today. Why? Because some of you, this is more for you if you're one of those that you've gotten quite routine in your faith, your walk with God. So much so to the point you'll catch yourself saying things like, oh yeah, right, God, got it, that's the big guy in the sky. And God is no longer all-powerful and all-present and something to be feared in a godly sense anymore. He's just up there. It's the point of this passage. It's really the point of where Moses is going to walk into this picture for us and show us all this. I want you to hear this first, because we sometimes miss this. Prayer can become just saying prayers instead of praying prayers for us. It can become just kind of routine instead of relationship when we small size God and miss how powerful He is. Think of God. God is this powerful, mighty, all present, all-knowing, all-powerful being. He's the maker, Acts says, of heaven and earth, the seas, the skies, and all that's in them. This is the same God who through His Son Jesus and the Holy Spirit conquered hell, Satan, death, demons, sin, and the grave. And yet, amazingly, He invites both of us, you and me, into personal relationship with Himself. So much so that when He shows up in the form of man in John 15, He says, I've called you my friends. That's incredible. Some of us are scared in the tent. We're aware that there's something wrong with us, and so we don't go out there because we think God will strike us. And we've seen God only as sort of this old, angry, powerful being that could hurt us. But some of us, we're walking with the Lord, but we've lost the awe of who God is. My hope is that we get a balance as we walk through here and look at this. Now, let's get the context of the passage we're going to look at. If you take notes, the central theme of the book of Exodus overall, first of all, is deliverance. If there's some sin that you're wrestling with, if there's some area that you're wrestling with, this is a great book to study and meditate on. It's full of themes that apply to us today around the topic of deliverance. Moses himself is sort of a type of Christ, if you will, in that he is chosen by God to deliver Israel out of Egypt. Egypt is really a picture of the world. And when Israel's deliverer comes to bring them out, he's taking them where? To the promised land. And the promised land's a picture of that abundant life where the people can now experience the grace and the promises of God. So you get this overlaid concept that God wants to take you by the hand out of the world and the things of the world and draw you into this abundant life with an all-powerful God through Jesus, His Son. Now in Exodus 33, we've just come out of that great scene where, and I don't mean great in a good way, where Israel saw Moses, Exodus 32, go up the mountain to receive the law on Mount Sinai, and he's gone for their liking a little too long. He's sort of been away, and really I call it what we do wrong when we get bored spiritually. That's, if you want a title for Exodus 32. They're kind of like, well, when's he coming out? Well, I don't know. Let's do something. Who has gold, right? And then out of this, they take all their gold and they make a calf, and you have that great part where when Moses does come down and he does this one-on-one with his assistant pastor, you know, he's like, Aaron, what happened? He's like, I don't know. They threw gold in and out came this cat, and he's lying, and you know, and it's just downhill. And then you have, you know, if you've seen the movie, that's where Charlton Heston takes the tablets and rah, throws them down, and it's just this big mess. That just ended. And there's a key verse, though, we will point to it, verse 30 of Exodus 32, look what it says. Now it came to pass on the next day, Moses said to the people, you've committed a great sin. No duh. So now I will go up to the Lord, perhaps I can make atonement for your sin. Do you see how he's a type of Christ? And it's so funny, you have to see the comedy in this, even though it's sad at the same time, because for the last five chapters, God and Moses go back and forth. They really do. God goes, these are my people, and then they mess up, and he goes, they're yours, Moses. And then Moses goes, okay, they're my people, and then they mess up, and he goes, they're yours, God. And they're really passing, if you follow it, back and forth, the people of Israel. It's like, I don't want them, they messed up, you take them, no, you have them. And so verse 30, he's like, I will be atonement if necessary. He offers his own life, just like Jesus. And it brings us right up to verse 1 of Exodus 33, where God's going to speak and God's going to lay down. How's it going to happen? This is what he says. The Lord said to Moses, depart and go up from here, you and the people whom you brought out of the land of Egypt, to the land of which I swore to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, saying, to your descendants I will give it, and I will send my angel before you, and I will drive out the Canaanite and Amorite, the Hivite, and all the other ones, right? Verse 3, go up to a land flowing with milk and honey, for I will not go up in your mists, lest I consume you on the way, for you are a stiff-necked people. And when the people heard this news, they mourned, and no one put on his ornaments. For the Lord said to Moses, say to the children of Israel, you're stiff-necked. I could come into your midst in one moment and consume you. Now therefore take off your ornaments, that I may know what to do to you. So the children of Israel stripped themselves of their ornaments by Mount Horeb. Okay, couple things. The first thing he says, you can see it right here in verse 1, is depart. This is the first thing. What he's saying is that this is a place of sin now. And if you want to enter in to relationship with me, you've got to leave a place of sin. That's the first thing. You can't stay where you are doing the things you're doing if they are against God and expect God to just be like, cool with that, and you're going to have a great time together as he just kind of overlooks. He does overlook your sins because of the blood of Jesus, but you can't excuse your sins and stay in your sins. There's a real relationship here. But then he gives a little promise. He says, verse 2, I will send my angel before you. Now, the word my, you know, the letter M in your Bibles is capital. We would call this a Christophany. That is an Old Testament appearance of Jesus. Now, usually when it says where there's a Christophany that's more solid evidence, it's called an angel of the Lord. So we don't know for sure, but most scholars say, well, this is Jesus right here. Also known as the angel of the Lord in the Old Testament. And so what he's saying here is, if you go out from this place of sin, I send my angel in. And what does he do? Look what it says. I will drive out, basically, your enemies. So let's start here. The problem that we have in the devotional life is always the same thing. And that is, if we don't remove ourselves from sin, or we do remove ourselves from him, we have a problem. Essentially, I think most of our life issues fall on one side of that equation or the other. There's either sin that I'm not removing myself from through the power of the Holy Spirit, or there's God who I have removed myself from. That's, you can boil down every issue. I mean, this is sort of, for some of you, you're like, I've heard this before, right? Because I'll tell you, most counseling can be solved with, how's your time with the Lord? And most react, who cares about that right now? Didn't you hear my issue? Didn't you hear the thing I'm going through? But what I know is that either there's sin that's not being removed, or you personally have removed yourself from the Lord. Because even if it's, you say, well, what about the situation? What if it's sickness? What if it's some tragedy? We're going to see that on your countenance if you walk with the Lord, how different that looks than if you simply walk with the situation. So it's always a place to draw people back, and that is devotions or the prayer life. And you know, one person said it this way. He said, when you're not praying, you're sinning, and when you're sinning, you're not praying. It's so simple, isn't it? Prayer really is, like I said last week, the acid test of devotion. You're not going to find, this is my Twitter heading, is you'll never be greater than your prayer life. True. You can't be. That's like saying I have 7 appointments with Jesus this week, first thing in the morning. But I you know, and then you're like, well, I blew all of them. I didn't meet him at all, but man, I'm on fire with the Lord. You can't. The two aren't congruent. You can't say one thing and not live in the same way. And that's the purpose of this study. But you know, right off the bat, I really want to just encourage you or challenge you to be honest as we go through this. Because what I've found is that part of the problem for me when it comes to devotions or the devotional life is I'm actually not honest either with myself or with others. So, because you know, I might be like, well, you know, I prayed an hour this week, so I'm just riding high. But then, you know, it can be a crushing blow to go, well, when was the last time you did that? 10 years ago. Or never. And there's this progression that God wants to see where we're growing in our relationship with the Lord. That starts with, first of all, departing from our sins and then coming to the Lord. Now, let's move on to verse 3. It says, go up to a land flowing with milk and honey, for I will not go in your midst, lest I consume you on the way, for your stiff-necked people. Here's the issue. Pride. The word stiff-necked means obstinate. It means against or proud. I'm not listening. I'm doing my own thing. That's what stiff-necked means. And what God is saying is that I want to take you into this abundant life, into this land where there's peace in your life. But the thing you got to get over is those areas you're not willing to give up or give over to me. I want you to go up to this land, but first you have to depart from that thing. And I don't know what it is, but the Lord does. And that's been my prayer, is that he would identify it. Well, here's what it was for them. Look at verse 5. For the Lord said to Moses, say to the children of Israel, you're a stiff-necked people. I could come up into your midst in one moment and consume you. Now therefore take off your ornaments that I may know what to do with you. So the children of Israel stripped themselves of their ornaments by Mount Horeb. Now don't miss this. Some of you hear that, you go, oh, come on. God of wrath right there. Look at that. He's like, take them off, or if I come into your presence, I'm going to wipe you out. This is actually the grace of God. Here's what God's saying. There's these areas of your life, Israel, this thing that you're holding on to. I don't want to get near you because I'm perfect, holy, and pure, and I cannot have sin in my presence. This is before the blood of Jesus covers over that. This is before the new covenant. So what he's saying is, you got to remove this, or I have to remove myself. It's actually grace. And then he says this word, and it's sort of strange if you read it. He says, you know, now therefore, verse 5, take off your ornaments. Now that's curious, isn't it? I kind of had this picture in my mind. When you think ornaments, what do you think? I don't know about you, but I think Christmas tree. Anybody? I was sort of picturing, you know, these like women's earrings with the iridescent bulbs with Santa and snowflakes. Is that what we're talking about? No. The word ornaments talks about, and if you take notes, write it down because it's important. Anything that you adorn yourself with or surround yourself with of value. I'll say it again. Anything that you adorn yourself with or surround yourself with of value in your daily life. You know, in a modern sense, you might call this bling, or the spiritual word swagger. But the general idea is unnecessary but adorning objects that you give great worth to. Interesting. That you give great value to. And I think beyond that, and that could be anything, by the way. That's not just jewelry. Amen, right? Some of the ladies are like, thank you for saying that. It could be your phone that you have to have with you at all times. It could be your clothes or your car, your toys or your hobbies. Now, I think perhaps that for them, the objects, and I want to make this point first, like jewelry had way more significance than it does today, believe it or not. Why? Because think about it. They weren't merely part of the ensemble of things that they own like it is for us. They were often the only precious thing that they had. The jewelry that the woman wore in the house was like, that's our inheritance, hold on to it. It wasn't like the jewelry that we have today. And often today even, we have a bunch of precious things, and so they're not precious anymore. Someone will say, oh, I lost my phone. But what they're really saying, you know, has anyone seen my phone? Oh, well, what they're really saying is I just put $750 somewhere and I can't find it. But we don't think that way, do we? It's like our phone and our keys sometimes are on the same level. Oh, my keys. But for them, it's prestige, it's future security. Interesting question. What is it for you? You know, in the original Hebrew, it adds the words trappings. The ornaments were trappings. Things that you own that sort of can trap you. And the idea here, I think beyond that, I think God is saying, look, when you came up the mountain, Moses, you and I met, the people were down in the valley, I had told them to take all the jewelry out of Egypt with them. That's what the Bible says. They carried it with them, but like anything, you carry it with you. If you're not careful, it can become an idol over me. And so now we're up the mountain, we're having a relationship, you better get back down there. They've taken their thing they carry with them and they've made it into an idol. That's why God cannot even have a little bit of it in the camp if he's going to take the people out of there. This is about sin. The ornaments, if they're not the actual sin of idolatry, they're the very reminder of it. This is any area of your life where God has clearly said, this is wicked, this is wrong, this is evil, get out of there. And you go, I'm out of there mostly. I just kind of got a foot still in there. I'm just going to, if I just keep a foot in there, maybe it'll be okay one day, but not now. This is sort of like the person who struggles with online pornography saying, you know what, I'm just going to keep my computer and I'm going to keep internet, but I'm in a good season right now. The Bible talks about these things as playing with fire, and God says, take these off and throw them down. And that's really so important. Because the promise he says here, back in 2, is that my angel will drive these things out. That the angel of the Lord, or Jesus, will drive out your enemies, but first you've got to remove yourself, you've got to depart from these things. And you can't sort of do this thing that sometimes people do, where they don't remove themselves for the enemies, but then they sort of say, well, I'm trusting the Lord. That's like charging your MasterCard, even though it's maxed out, and saying, Lord, just bless me anyway. You know, the mentality that, well, if it's wrong, Lord, stop me. Yet if you're not in it, prevent me from doing this. It's like putting your car on a railroad track and praying that the train doesn't hit your car. That's what God is saying. No, you've got to remove yourself because it's going to be deadly. Now, church, I don't know what it is, but God does. And every one of us has ornaments in our life. Every one of us has precious things to us. And some of us, if we're really honest, we know God told us, give this up, give this over, get rid of this, depart from this, because I want to bless you and I want you to get in a vehicle marked Jesus and I'm going to drive you out of this place, and then he's going to drive your enemies the opposite direction. And I don't think it's always about just getting honest about the same thing over and over again. I think it's doing hard business with the Lord. And I don't think it's just about erring on the side of, well, I'm going to make a new commitment. I think it's honestly about sharing with someone and saying, let's walk this out together. And why do we put so much emphasis on it? So the reason is because if you could break down Exodus 33 verse 1 to 11 into two chunks, and this is so huge when it comes to a heart of prayer, the first 6 verses would be called remove it. And then verse 7 to 11, you could call that replace it. And why is this so important? Because I'll talk to people all the time. They'd be like, oh, yeah, I'm not getting anything out of devotion. Or, you know, I'm my quiet time with the Lord. I'm not really connecting with the Bible. Or prayer's kind of dry or short. And it's like, well, look, do you still have a foot in some area of sin? Because the psalmist wrote this. He said, the Lord will not even hear your prayers if you regard iniquity or sin in your life. So if there's some area that you're just playing around and then you're wondering why your relationship's dry with the Lord, the two are very connected. And then through his grace and the power of the Holy Spirit, I got to remove myself. And then all of a sudden I start replacing myself with the Lord and you get alive again. And you start hearing from him and he's hearing from you. So I've got to remove myself, and then I've got to draw near to God. And the scriptures say in James that when we draw near to God, he will draw near to us. Look at verse 7. And now this really lays out how to replace, and I really just wrote down, these are some great practical applications on the devotional life. Verse 7, Moses, and this is after they've removed their ornaments, they've come clean, and now they're out in a new place. And so what does Moses do? Here's what he does. He's taking leadership. Moses took his tent and pitched it outside the camp, far from the camp, and called it the Tabernacle of Meeting. I love this. Here's the first thing he does. Ready? He takes his own tent and he pitches it way outside the camp. Isn't that good? Now the Hebrew word is ohel, translated tabernacle in this passage. And the tabernacle spoken of here is not the tabernacle Moses was given instruction later to build. This is actually, the tabernacle is the meeting place. That's what it means. Meeting place for the congregation. And so Moses packs up the meeting place and he repitches his tent outside the camp, far from the other people. And the question might be, first of all, well, why? Because God had previously, in a previous chapter, promised him, I will not be in your camp. So Moses says, well, okay, if God's not there, I don't want to be there either. And he gets out of town. But I love these words, outside and far from the camp. I see a great application for us. I see that you and I desperately need times of pitching our tent outside the camp of busyness in order that we might be aware of the presence of God again. That there's a need for us to kind of remove ourselves from the busyness and the people and get alone with God. Do you ever feel that way? I know I do. I know when I zoned in on this passage, it was convicting right off the bat. I thought, wow, Lord. First thing I see is he just kind of goes, I'm out of here, and I'm going to just remove myself from things. Now, I don't know what your remove is. Some, it's location, right? We talked about that last week. Some, you got to remove yourself from the bed. That's a start. Great. Baby steps. But some, it might be that you've got to remove yourself from the busyness. But if you're quite honest, the first thing you do when you wake up is turn on your phone or talk to people or go straight to work. And so now that's your mind all day. You're doing this. You haven't removed yourself to spend time with the Lord and separate and protect that time. And then you wonder why things just get crazier and crazier. Recently, my wife called me on this. I had a rule of not bringing work home. And just this last week, ironically, the week of prayer, well, I was probably bringing it home because there was a lot going on, but still. At one point, I had my laptop on my lap, go figure, and I'm typing away, and she said something, and I didn't really hear it because I'm like engaged, and I said, yeah, just a sec, honey, and she's like, no. I'm like, oh, what? She's like, that's the third time you've said just a sec to me. And anybody have a wife like this? God bless her. And I was like, oh. And I realized in that moment that I had brought something home which interrupts. And I realized in that moment, and we had this little talk, I thought, oh, I can't do this. I can't bring something that interrupts the relationship all the time, so just having a normal conversation means it's you, me, and my phone, or you, me, and my laptop, or you, me, and whatever your distraction is, TV or whatever it may be. You know, it's the same with the Lord. You have to separate yourself from the interruptions. You have to separate yourself from the busyness like Moses and get away with the Lord. Jesus did that in Mark chapter 1. It says he got up early and went away by himself to a place alone and there talked with God. That's prayer. The heart of prayer starts with removing yourself from sin and then removing yourself from any stuff that is going to keep you from God or distract you from time with Him. You know what I found, church? If I have consistency there, I have consistency everywhere. I don't know about you, but even watching the time I go to sleep and the time I wake up, if I can make those consistent, it seems things just click. But when those are interrupted and disrupted, and I don't know why, spending time alone with the living God seems to be one of those things I'll either shortchange or cut back or just change it a little bit, because you know what? He's flexible. He'll always be there. And I'm not giving God my best anymore. Look what it says next in verse 7. He called it the Tabernacle of Meeting. I like that. He named this place. I mean, I don't want to make too much of this, but, you know, it's a good question. Did God tell him to call it the Tabernacle of Meeting? No, we don't know. But Moses named it. And And I don't think Moses was thinking that this was just about him, because previously we know the congregation met at these tabernacles. I think what he's doing is he's defining a place that he can meet with God. It's sort of like having some area in your house that you call your area to meet with God. That chair or whatever. Or that room. Andrew Murray wrote, "Let the place of secret prayer become to me the most beloved spot on earth." Isn't that good? My need to restore the importance of that place. Then it says this, "And it came to pass that everyone who sought the Lord went out to the tabernacle of meeting, which was outside the camp." Now, read those words carefully. It doesn't say everybody went out to where Moses was. On a first reading, that's what I thought it said. But as you read back through, look at these words. "It came to pass that everyone who sought the Lord went out to the tabernacle of meeting, which was outside the camp." Everyone who sought the Lord. So there were those who didn't seek the Lord, and they missed out on meeting with the Lord. And there's those who did seek the Lord, and like Moses, they met the Lord. Which camp are you in? I don't know about you, but I want to be those who are continually seeking the Lord. I don't want to rest on the things God showed me yesterday or last year. I want to keep seeking the Lord. I want to keep going after the Lord. Somebody asked me about the prayer nights. We had five, Monday to Friday, for 1 hour. Which night was the best night? And they asked me this, I think, I think it was Friday they said this, before we'd gotten to the last night. And so I said, the next. So what do you mean the next? I said, well, that's the thing about prayer. It grows. If you go on the first night, it's awesome to get together and pray with the body of Christ. But the second night is awesomer. And then the third night, yeah, I won't even make up a word for that. But you get the idea? See, prayer grows just like a relationship. So that on Thursday it was explosive and Friday amazing. That's how God works. And it's not this growing emotionalism. It's just the burden and the response and the answers to prayer keeps growing every day. Why do I say this? We can't go back to where we were. We have to be those that are constantly going out to seek the Lord afresh. It's one of these classic things we do as individuals, is sort of to rest on the victories of yesterday. Well, wasn't it great when the Lord did this? Do you remember when God answered that prayer? Wasn't that great? We need new prayers that God's answering. We need new ministries that God's forming. We need new vision that God's doing for today, not constantly looking back on the good old days. Verse 8, "So it was, whenever Moses went out to the tabernacle, that all the people rose, and each man stood at his tent door and watched Moses until he'd gone into the tabernacle." I love this. This is a great verse. This is it. This is the spiritual life that is lived out for others to see. I mean, he goes out to meet with God. I don't think he cares about anybody else watching, which is a good little application, right? He's not like, "I'm going out. Anybody want to watch me? Here I go. Got my Bible. Just going to read my Bible." You know, like, my kids are funny. I won't say who, but one of them was asking the whole family yesterday, "Who do you think's the most spiritual in our house, Dad?" And then two of them got in an argument over it. And she's like, "No, definitely me." Or sorry, she or he. Was like, "Well, it's definitely me and Mom." "No, it's me and Dad," or "It's me and," you know. We figured out Cruz was probably the most spiritual. He spent more time resting in the Lord and waiting on the Lord than any of us. And crying out to the Lord. I couldn't make one for diapers. I mean, it's so funny, isn't it? I don't think Moses cares. He's like, "I really don't care what's going on. I just want to go meet with God." And so he goes. But you know what the Bible tells us right here? I mean, think of this for a second. You got a swack of people out in the desert. Moses gets up. He goes out to the tabernacle. And everybody gets up.
And oh, they're all standing at their tent door and watching Moses until he goes into the tabernacle. Now, some of this has to do with the whole golden calf debacle, right? We understand that. People aren't saying much. They're just like, okay, we'll take Moses' lead from now on. So we won't speak, we'll just watch. So there's a lot of fear, for sure. But I think that there's, I think this in the camp was the exciting new thing. Do you understand? God had dealt with sin radically in chapter 32. The people were plagued, the Bible says, because of that choice. Moses mediates in verse 30, and then in 1 to 6, God says, well, you got to call them on this sin. They got to take off even the reminder of it and throw it down and replace it with me. And then in verse 7, as Moses goes out, everybody is watching. There's sort of murmurings. Now, the Bible says they all watched for when he got up, and then they rose. And I don't know why, but I sort of picture this as the main event in their life every day. That means you got to get up before Moses. That means you're sort of talking amongst yourself. Did you see him yet? Did he get up? Did he go yet? Did anybody see? And then, you know, there's all eyes on the tent because everybody saw it. So then the flap opened and everybody goes, he's coming out of the tent. You know, it's the play-by-play. Kids, gather around. There he is. And so as Moses goes, it's like the main thing. And then everybody's asking, did it happen yet? Did it happen yet? I kind of picture this like movies. You ever watch a movie? Anybody have a family member you watch a movie with and they're asking you constantly, what just happened? Who's he? Why did they say that? Darian, you know what I'm talking about? Eventually you just turn to this person and go, we're watching the same movie at the same time. Sorry, but have you had that? That's what's going on in the camp. They're getting excited. Moses is going to meet with God. But then he goes and meets with God. He gets away from the busyness. He's out there, just him and God. And some of them, this is like, wow. This is this amazing moment in their lives. They see him meet with God. Now, look how it happens in verse 9. And it came to pass when Moses entered the tabernacle, the pillar of cloud descended and stood at the door of the tabernacle. And the Lord talked with Moses. Isn't that awesome? So when Moses is obedient to go and separate himself from sin, and the people separate themselves from sin to remove sin and then replace it with God and get out away from the busyness and the craziness, one-on-one with God, what's the blessing? Here's the blessing. God shows up. It's simple, isn't it? The pillar of cloud descends and stands at the door of the tabernacle. You know what? I looked up pillar. You know what it means? Pillar. There's really not a lot on this one. One guy went out on a limb and said, it's like a column. If you look up column, guess what it says? Pillar. Okay. Just glad we cleared that up. So we don't know, but it's this cloud that comes and forms right in front of the tent where Moses is, like a pillar. Good, you got it. All right. So, but you can imagine, you wake up. I mean, just picture this yourself. You get up in the morning, and maybe this will be a miracle for your wife. Set the alarm. Guys, you're up at like 5:30. You're like, I'm going downstairs. She's like, what are you doing? I'm going to have devotions. Going to meet with God, right? You go down to the basement. You're down in the basement. All of a sudden, smoke starts coming up through the house. Because this cloud just goes into the house. Now you say, what do you mean? Just picture this for the people. I mean, God leaves us in here because he wants us to get this strong picture of when you come to meet with me, I come to meet with you without fail. If you come to meet with me and you got ornaments, I'm not coming to meet with you. Get rid of the ornaments. But if you come to meet with me with a clean heart, I'm coming to meet with you. And stuff is going to happen. That's what he's saying. Verse 10, all the people saw the pillar of cloud standing at the tabernacle door. See how this is the main event for them? Watching God show up in Moses' life. And it says, and all the people rose and worshiped. I bet they did. each man in his tent door. Isn't that awesome? You know the word worship here is the word shakah? And it's sort of ironic because it says all the people rose in worship, but the word shakah means fell on their face. I don't know what that looks like, you know, because if you follow it, and this is called I Had Too Much Time to Study This, but if you followed it, it sounds like the people rose up, look out the tent door, watch, the cloud comes down, right? And then they fall on their face, but they rise up and worship. So they're basically going up, down, up, down, up, down. That's okay. We do that every Sunday, don't we? Sit down, stand up, sit down, stand up. For these guys, they went further. They fell on their face. That's what it means. Now that's a little different, isn't it? I want to talk about this. When you get in the presence of God, you know what grows in you personally? Worship. I had fun Friday night before the prayer meeting. There was like 10 people that were there early. And I said, this is really funny. Not everybody's here yet. It'd be really funny. We should all get on our faces. And when they're coming in, it's like, they're coming in and they're like, what on earth is going on? Like, oh, you missed it. It was amazing. Just sort of mess with people's minds. And I was joking. We had a good laugh about it. Oh, we wouldn't do that. That would look weird. But the reality is, when you follow it through the scripture, it happened a lot. Why do I bring this up? We have to be careful of how comfortable we are in the form of worship. Did you know that? Do we get so comfortable with the routine? Well, oh, this is three songs standing. When is he going to say sit down? Right? And I was saying this to the guys at our lead ministry yesterday morning. It's amazing when you watch some of us go to like a sports event. I had a free ticket to the Stampeders. I don't know what that was, a year ago. And I've never been to a Stampeders game. All I know is the guy that sat right in front of me in Roman had horns on. Face paint, okay? And a number, like, painted on him. And a lot of alcohol. And he was screaming the whole time. And when I was sitting with Roman, he's up there going, like this the whole time. He's got his hands in the air, he's yelling, he's screaming, he's hooting and hollering. And I heard this on a sermon a couple weeks ago, and I thought, that's such a good point. We see people like that, and we go, yeah, that's the spirit. And we get in church, somebody lifts their hands up, we're like, oh, he's weird. He's over the top. Right? You have to understand, when you're doing something for emotionalism or reaction or for people, you're really not in the presence of God. But when you're in the presence of God, it will cause you to look a little different in the worship of God. You'll have this sort of abandonment to say, I don't really care. I don't really care who's watching. It's not about charismatic or Pentecostal. It's called, I just want to surrender everything to the Lord. And sometimes that can be something that you know, God has to work in our hearts to get over. These guys saw the cloud. They saw the door. Did they run to Moses' door like people would today? Nope. They'd just gone through the whole golden calf incident. So the Bible says, you know, they're quite reserved here. Look what it says again. All the people saw the pillar of cloud standing at the door, and then they rose and worshipped in his own tent door. They're a little safer right now. But there's this radical expression of worship to the Lord. And then, look what it says, verse 11. So the Lord spoke to Moses face to face as a man speaks to his friend, and he would return to the camp. And then these great words, but his servant Joshua, the son of Nun, a young man, did not depart from the tabernacle. I love that it closes off with this. Moses goes in, meets with God. They have a face-to-face conversation, just like Jesus said, I've called you my friends. And then it says he speaks to him as a friend, and he would return to the camp. But look what it says here. He's going back to the camp, but he's leaving behind a young man. See, some watched from afar. And people are like this today, and they sort of see spirituality, or they see Jesus, or church, or believers, or they see religion even in their own mind. They would call it that. and they see it from a distance, and they'll maybe even have that relationship where they know God, and they'll worship from afar. But one man goes and runs to the same place and says, "What you had, Moses, I want." And I just think this is so huge. That our devotional life, our walk with the Lord, sometimes can seem like it's all about me and Him. We talk that way, don't we? Oh, it's my personal relationship with the Lord. And there is room to say that. But the huge thing that Moses leaves behind here is a young man named Joshua, who did not depart from the presence of the Lord. When Moses leaves the presence of God, he leaves a young man there. Parents, do you see this? Youth workers, do you see this? Kids ministry teachers, big brothers, big sisters, do you get this? Employers, I'll say it again, our devotional life is not only about us, it's about the people around us. I had the great joy the other day of sitting on the couch, writing my journal, and looking up and seeing my two girls writing in their journal. And I wrote in my journal, "God, this is one of the greatest moments of my life." And they didn't know, they're just busy scribbling, and one of them's got a Bible and it's upside down. So I don't think they're really getting anything. They're just like, "This is cool to do, so I'm doing it." The other one's reading verse by verse, chapter by chapter through the Bible right now. But anyway. But I watched them and I'm like, this is amazing. And then I was overcome with grief because I thought, man, I'm like proud daddy in this moment because my girls are copying me. But it's taken some time for me to do that. I was like, wow, I should have helped them do this earlier. And remember, we had this fun thing where I would wake them up in the morning and make breakfast with them and then do devotions. But why did I start now? They're 6 and 7. Almost 6 and 7 years old. Why didn't I start a couple years ago? And even the Lord encouraged me, like, who cares? Just, you are starting now. And I think it might be the same encouragement to some of you. Who cares? Hey, you're starting now. Start. Start to model that. Start to talk about your walk with the Lord, with your kids. Start to get into the lives of the people that you minister to who are behind you, the Joshuas. Start to really care. Don't do ministry for or with them. Like walk with Jesus and let them see it. Dan, great. You stole my line. You don't have to advertise for fire. If you're getting on fire with the Lord, your kids are going to see it. Employees are going to see it. You won't have to mandate it. We're all doing a Bible study, so we look spiritual or are spiritual eventually. You just live it. Just dedicate to that time. Lord, I'm going to give you my first fruit and my best in the day. It's yours, Lord. And you can just start even today by going, "Lord, I'm so sorry. I've not done that. But I want to start now afresh." Here's a great verse in Philippians as the worship team comes up. We're going to close in a song. Great, great verse in Philippians. It says, "Forgetting what is behind, I press on to the upward call of Christ Jesus." You know, sometimes devotions, prayer, time in the Bible can be more of this sort of, oh, here we go. He's going to beat us up. Oh, another reminder, I'm not good enough. You know what? Let's just assume it all starts tomorrow or today. But tomorrow morning, set that time with the Lord and press into fellowship with Him. And then let His glory come down and meet you in the place of meeting that you've set up. And just say, "Tomorrow I'm meeting with God." And then remove the busyness and then remove the sin first. Do that now. And then remove all the interruptions. And then set that time and go meet with the Lord away from everything else. And if you start putting those things in place and not walking in the guilt of what you haven't done, but the grace of what God's going to do, You're going to be so encouraged because eventually you're going to look around, you're going to see other people are doing the same thing that you're doing. Well, what about all the lost years, Joel? What about all the lost time? Just start now. Just start now with the Lord. Just start now pouring into your relationship with Him. You know, I want to close by giving you a little bit of a fun study tip here. I spent a lot of time just studying for fun what the tabernacle or the tents looked like back then, what they looked like. And you know what they were? They were either goat or ram skins. And so you know what they had to do? They had to sacrifice a goat or a ram, slaughter one, get rid of the blood, and then make this covering. And so they would take wooden posts, and they would bind those posts together, and then cover it over. And so last night, Tanya and I were sitting on the couch, and I'm having this moment. I'm like, wow, that is so cool. She said, what? I said, catch this. God will only meet with men under the covering of a blood sacrifice. Wow. But when the posts are put together and the covering is blood, God comes in and meets. Isn't that awesome? Because it just made me think of how awesome the Lord is, and that this picture, that He will meet with us under the covering of the Lamb of God, the blood that was shed for you, that was paid for our sins, that we can justify and excuse and explain away our sins. But Jesus comes and He takes away our sins, the perfect Lamb of God with His own blood. And then He invites us to receive that freely, that covering over us, so that we can have relationship with God. And Hebrews 3 talks all about that. That Moses, that, you know, that was one thing to have him there, but Jesus is better. Jesus comes in and shows up and covers over our sin. The Bible says that He will not answer our prayers if we regard iniquity in our hearts. So I want to ask you a question just as we close in worship here. Have you been covered over by the blood of Jesus, by His sacrifice? Has He paid for your sins? So that you can now come boldly, like Hebrews says, into the throne room of God. Has His Spirit taken up residence in your heart so that you can now become the temple, as the Bible says, of the living God? You say, well, how would I know? The Bible says the Spirit Himself testifies with our own spirit that we're saved, whether we're in Christ. So then what? So then just ask Him right now. Just ask Him. Have my sins been forgiven? Has sin been removed? Has it been? It has been paid for, but if I receive that free gift of salvation because of the blood of the Lamb, am I covered over? And those of you that know the Lord, is He calling you back to that heart of prayer? That place where just you and Him meet? That place of devotion? And then maybe for you, you've looked for some secret that you're missing. You know, there's some magic bullet to prayer. There isn't. It's just coming. It's removing yourself from sin, and it's replacing it with Him and just meeting with Him. I love one guy, one author said, the secret of praying is praying in secret. That's it. There's no magic pill. It's simply meeting with the Lord.